Welcome, everybody. My name is Sergio Vergalli. I'm program director of Fondazione Eni Enrico Mattei. My research program is called Modeling the Energy Transition. The interview of today is a part of FEEM Reality Check online series. This event aims at bringing experts to discuss prominent theme of our year on the relationship between science and art in the increasingly complex dynamic with the reality in the making. We started on February 2023 with a debate between the novelist and journalist Jonathan Franzen and the executive director of FEEM, Fondazione Enrico Mattei, Professor Alessandro Lanza. Today, we have an honor to have here Professor William Nordhaus, Nobel Prize 2018 in economics. William Nordhaus is a still in professor of economics at Yale University. He has served as president of American Economic Association, provost of Yale University, as economic advisor to President Jimmy Carter. His major work focuses on the economics of climate change, developing models that integrate science, economics, and politics necessary to slow warming. And these studies include a model is called DICE, Dynamic Integrated Climate Economic Model, and also another version that is called RISE model, that is a regional one. And these models combine economics work on climate change, which has been widely used in research and studies on climate change, economic, and policy. And in 2018, he was awarded the Nobel Prize in Economics for integrated climate change into long-run macroeconomic analysis. I have to say that for us, it's very important, for FEEM, it's very important, Professor Nordhaus, not only because he has written more than 180 papers and 24 books, and he has also written a book, the last book was published in 2021, the title, The Spirit of Green, that is here, is a very important, interesting book. And for me, it's a pleasure to have here and an honor, also because for me, it's also, and also for FEEM, is a part of our history. FEEM started to work on integrated assessment model, and this work has been worked on integrated assessment model for more than 20 years. I started in 2000 on RISE model of Professor Nordhaus. For me, is a part of my research. And I think also it's very important also for research in general, the Nobel Prize, but also total is research, because is something that is related to the debate on climate change, the development, how the development could be a part also of this effort of humanity in order to control the increase of temperature. So it's a pleasure to have here Professor Nordhaus, and we start now to speak about some interesting points. And we start with one of these, especially in this case on climate change. According to the last IPCC report, there will be three different scenarios for an increase of temperature. These scenarios are in three different cases. The first one is about low emissions. Another is about medium emissions, and another is about high emissions. Looking at this, we have different types of scenarios that includes an increase of temperature that is ranging between plus 1 Celsius degree to 5.7 Celsius degrees over the years 2081 and 2100. The first question is this one: what is your opinion about these scenarios' very probability? What could be the most realistic scenario, and what are the tools to realize it?
Oh, thank you very much, Sergio, and it's very good to be here. I've visited FEEM, and I know many of the researchers. I'm a big admirer of FEEM and its work, one of the great research institutes in Europe today. Let me start by saying a word about your question about likely scenarios. We are just in the middle of publishing our update of the DICE model, DICE 223. It's co-authored with Lint Barrage, who's an environmental economist at ETH Zurich. And it's in preprint form, waiting for journals to decide upon it. But I think it's pretty clear what it says, and it's been pretty stable over the last year or so. So the DICE model, as you explained it, is an integrated assessment model It starts with the fundamentals such as population technology through emissions, climate modeling, carbon cycle modeling, damages, temperature, and so on. And it allows to do kind of end to end. And so you don't make arbitrary assumptions about emissions, say. So I particularly like the integrated approach because it's internally consistent and it's transparent. So in a way, the question you asked about likely scenarios, we ask in a specific way in the DICE model as follows. First, there is a first scenario, which is to take the current minimal policy. As you know, carbon prices are very low. Climate policies are very weak around the world, not particularly in Europe, but in other places. And with that, our estimate is that warming by 2100, which I think is a good date to keep in mind, will be a little under 4°C relative to pre-industrial times, 3.8 to be precise, but that has an error band around it. So not unlike the numbers you cited, but it's very clear that projection of climate is related to policy, and that's weak policy. Now, if we take the Paris Accord and we take the commitments to 2030 and then extend those in a reasonable way, that actually reduces it, but not all that much, to about 3.2°C by 2100. So it's not going to get to our targets, but it has a substantial impact. Finally, I'll say something about the 1.5°C target, which has been so much talked about. We think that is infeasible in any realistic way. In fact, we think that we'll probably hit the 1.5°C sometime later in this decade. It's just there's too much momentum in the system. Even if we were to take strong steps, we'd basically have to have a global depression of catastrophic nature to hit the 1.5°C because there's just so much momentum. So I assume at some point, even though we debate, is it 1.5°? Should we do? What should we do? That's going to be history pretty soon. And then we'll have to really refocus our efforts. You ask about the most realistic scenario. I would say it's hard to be optimistic given the current situation, the political situation, the divide in the United States, the divide among countries, the conflicts around the world, the coldness of the international diplomatic scene. There hasn't been much momentum to have strong climate policies, and it's hard to see it in place. I think the Paris Accord, if we can do that, that'll be a good outcome. But as far as getting to these very ambitious targets, there'll have to be a world change in diplomacy, internal policies, international policies, and agreements.
Okay, thank you. See, yeah, linked to visa is one of the possible strategies that can be adopted in order to control the climate change is this kind of this net zero emission target, you know, that it was defined by European Union, but not only. So there are different types of net zero emission targets in different countries. In Europe, we are speaking about 2050. Do you think that it's possible to reach this target?
Of course, it's possible. The question of whether it's likely. As we look at both the modeling in this area, not only the modeling we do at Yale University, but the modeling done by your researchers at FEEM and around the world, it's going to require a real discontinuity in climate policies to have net zero emissions. I think we have to remember that to hit net zero emissions, emissions will have to turn down very sharply very soon. And actually, they haven't even turned down yet. They're continuing to grow. So it's going to take very strong policies. Now, one way to think of net zero is what kind of policies would lead to that. So we've done some modeling of that. Just to be set the background, a way of thinking of policy is the equivalent carbon price. So the equivalent carbon price in the world today is around $5 per ton of CO2 emissions. Now that's a combination of relatively high prices in Europe, in the EU, and very low prices in most of the rest of the world, including the United States. So that's where we are now, about $5 a ton. That's been going up slightly, but just slightly. Our estimate is to reach the 2°C target, or to get to net zero. We don't have to get there 2050, we have to get there 2060 or something like that, would require about $250 a ton of CO2. So a very, very sharp acceleration in policy from $5 to $250. So very, very substantial. Now, our estimates is that the Paris Accord might get us a third of the way there, or if we're optimistic, a half of the way there. So we've got policies in place. They're better than nothing, but they're nowhere near enough to reach the net zero target by mid-century.
Okay, thank you. So you have spoken about so some policies, also some obstacles that are related to the possibility to reach this target. So carbon tax is one of the possible instruments in order to reach the control of CO2 emissions, so the control of increase of temperature, and policies that can be adopted is another part. Another thing that you have said so far is that in some cases we have some problems related to the coordination of countries, because in some cases, you know, that we have some countries that are not coordinated in order to control. We see, for example, in a conference of parties, in some cases, is different to have some solution. So the question is this one, according to this, which could be the main obstacles, according to your opinion, more than some that you have said so far, in order to reach this target? And on the other part, which could be the possible solutions?
Yeah, well, let's start with the obstacles. Basically, the obstacles today are the obstacles we've had all along. And they're the obstacles, the very, very difficult obstacles that are raised by global problems, by global environmental problems, by global security problems, by all kinds of global problems. And they're nothing new, but they're the same ones we face today as we faced in the past. The first one is you have the economic interests of energy producers. So these would be the export, not just the producers, but primarily the exporters of oil, the exporters of natural gas, the exporters of coal, who would see their economic interests hurt by strong climate policies, because the purpose of strong climate policies is to reduce the consumption and therefore the production of fossil fuels. So it's quite natural that countries who look at their own economic self-interest would oppose these. So those are a wide variety of countries, obviously the oil exporting countries, but other countries as well. A second item, which is particular to this time, but not universally so, is the internal political obstacles in countries, particularly the United States. The United States, we have, we are not all that divided in terms of the public, but we have a great political divide. And the Republican Party is just completely against any kind of climate policy. The presidential nominees or likely nominees, the past Republican presidential nominees, every member of the US Senate who's a Republican, with one exception, thinks that climate policy is unnecessary or useless or worse. And then the third, which is, I mentioned at the beginning, the third obstacle, which is in a way the most powerful obstacle, is free riding. Preventing climate change is a global public good. It's a global enterprise. And so any single country, first place, can't do it alone, can't prevent it alone. And secondly, won't derive the benefits from its own actions. So this is a standard, if you like, tragedy of the commons, global public good. And this is, it's a particularly a difficult one, because not only is it one where you have this global public goods problem or the commons problem, but it's one which lasts years and years and decades and generations. So when you take steps today, not only do we not benefit in the United States or in Italy or in China, but we don't even benefit today. We would benefit in the next generation or the next generation. Now, of course, it's getting closer because the problems are getting closer, But those three problems, the problems of internal politics, the problems of energy producers, and the problem of this free riding have been very important ones and very important obstacles. They won't go away. There are solutions to them, but they won't go away.
Yeah, thank you. So I understand a lot of big problems. So free riding, tragedy of commons, public good that you have said, stressed this point. In this point, one of the possible solutions is to work on energy or ecological transitions, to think about whether energy ecological transition could be one of the possible instruments, or can I say transition, in order to work against this and to work together, probably avoiding this tragedy of commons related to the problem related to climate change. So how do you think the energy ecological transition will play out? Do you think that some elements have been left out from a current framework and policies? So something maybe is left out and we can work in this direction.
I think one way to think of it is we have these obstacles to making a transition to a low carbon green economy. And how do we overcome them? We have overcome problems in the past, and how do we overcome this one? So as I think about, I think of a three-part strategy. One we've talked about already, which is the importance of carbon pricing. I mean, this is almost a cliche, but it doesn't mean it's untrue. It's actually extremely important that people face the cost of their activities in their everyday lives. And this would be individuals like you and me and everyone else in our economies. It would be firms who buy and sell things, but also innovate. It even is governments who buy and sell goods and services. So each of these areas, and there are billions of consumers and millions of firms and thousands of governments, and they all need to face realistic cost of their activities in the form of carbon pricing. I'd say that's a really necessary condition to making steps forward. And there are ways of doing it. We know how to do it. Europe has done it through the cap and trade. Other countries have done it through carbon taxes. It's something that was a mystery 4 decades ago, but it's not a mystery today. Then the second one is the problem of how to handle the international public goods issue, global public goods issue. And on that, I think all economists who think of this, almost every economist I've ever met realize, yes, you have to have carbon pricing. There are different ways of doing that, and they might argue about the levels, and they might argue about which mechanisms you use, but it's virtually unanimous among economists who've thought about this, and some who haven't, that you need carbon pricing. You need the price of emissions. So a second thing then is how to handle the global public goods issue. And here, I would say there's less agreement, but one idea which I've been associated with is the idea of a climate club. And this is the idea that countries get together to set targets, say carbon price targets, and with penalties for non-performance. Now, this is an idea that's been developed. It would have some kind of sanctions. One way would be, say, through trade sanctions, such as tariffs or something. Now, it's interesting because the EU is a kind of climate club. It's a club where the benefits are the participation and the membership with all that means. And the obligation is you have to do your share in the common climate policy of the EU. So the EU is the model, actually, for a climate club. It would be different for other countries and to include other countries, but the EU has shown this can work in a multinational framework. Then I'd add a third thing, which I think has been insufficiently emphasized in the professional discussion, which is we need much more emphasis on green R&D. If you go look at the numbers on the government support of energy R&D, first place, it's very small. But then if you look at it, what is there is insufficiently devoted to what I'll call green energy research and development. That's to say, research and development on renewables. the International Energy Agency collects data on that. And it's interesting that total research and development, private and public, on low carbon energy R&D is only $40 billion. This is in an industry where the sales are about $10 trillion. So tiny, tiny little fraction. And of that 40 billion, about 30 billion is private. And that 30 billion, it's mainly automobiles. So the R&D to develop electric automobiles, so the R&D to do model changes. And only $10 billion of government support of low carbon technologies. If you look in detail at the US, it's only about $1 billion. So one of the things we need, this is another global public good, the global public good of innovation, the global public good of knowledge, the global public good of new technologies. And it's even a double externality because the output here is underpriced. We need a major increase in government support of low carbon energy R&D. We need to just substantially increase it. I would add that one of the very, very sad parts of the US climate policy, the bill that was passed last year, was included essentially nothing for energy R&D. It had nothing for climate, it had nothing for carbon pricing either. It didn't have a climate club in it either. It had some subsidies and various things. But I'd say of the three things that are absolutely essential, carbon pricing, the climate club, and energy R&D, there was virtually nothing in the US policy passed last year. But I think this, if we think in, just keep in mind these three things, carbon pricing, climate, international climate club, and enhanced energy, low green R&D, I think if we keep our eye on those three things, we will make a lot of progress.
Okay, thank you. A very important point, I think. Thank you very much. It's very clear also with the point about these policies that I hope we can enhance in this direction. Also a good point to know that EU can be also think about like, it could be thought also about a climate club, so it's quite similar to climate club. And now moving a debate that there is in literature, but also in related to policies, one of the possible debate is related to mitigation versus adaptation. No? So we, in some cases, we would like to control the emission of CO2, so we reduce, and also in other cases, we are saying that unfortunately, we know we are not able to control the temperature. We know that there are a lot of different disasters and increase of the climate disaster. And so we have to adapt in this direction. The point is, which is the combination of the two, where is one that is more important with respect to another one, or we have to think about both in the debate, so in the, sorry, in enhancing this effort in order to control CO2.
Well, I think the main thing, I'll just say one simple thing, and then I'll talk about it a little more. We should mitigate, but we're not. We will adapt because we must. Okay. So those are the key points. So with respect to mitigation, what we've been talking about up to now, reducing CO2 emissions, reaching net zero, these are steps that would require countries collectively to work together. But for global reasons in the near or distant future with the global public goods. Adaptation is a completely different story. Adaptation is something we do to protect ourselves as a nation, as nations, as cities, as states, as provinces, as households. So for example, if we're in a city where maybe we don't need to worry about air conditioning because the summers are not hot now, and we understand it's going to get much hotter, then we can adapt by air conditioning. Or we can build houses that are adapted that may not need so much heating. Or we can adapt to sea level rise by dealing with the coastal settlements. So there are many, many areas. fire prevention in forest fires, many, many different areas. But these are generally local, not local in the sense of right in our very city, but they're not global, and they're not there. They're the near future. There are things we have to do to cope with the world. It's as if the world is changing because the politics changes, or the economy changes, or the financial institutes change, or you're in a war zone. You need to adapt to that, and you do adapt to that. So mitigate, we've been talking about mitigation, which is prevention up to now. Very difficult. We haven't made many steps. Adaptation, we will. Now, many of the adaptations will be need to be nursed along by the government, because perhaps people are myopic. People, we don't expect people to understand all the forecasts and which ones and so on. So the governments will have to help through all kinds of instruments, the different instruments in different countries. But that's something that's going to occur. And it's going to occur differently in different places. Places that are prone to hurricanes will have to change their hurricane zones. Yep. Places that are prone to floods, places that are prone to wildfires. Each of these will have their different adaptations. We don't have to adapt. Florida doesn't have to adapt to wildfires, and New Mexico doesn't have to adapt to hurricanes. So these are things that are local. They will be done. They're important. They'll be moderately expensive, and they can be very, very effective. I'll just say one last thing on adaptation. We've seen in our studies of adaptation that the cost of climate change can be dramatically reduced if we do wise adaptation. So while you sort of have a left brain, right brain, the left brain is working on mitigation, the right brain really needs to think very carefully about how to optimize our adaptation.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. We have spoken about climate change, but one of the problems also looking to the future is to think about that maybe we have other problems or other important big issues. And which issues are other than climate change would you prioritize for our future? So there are other things. So for example, inequalities, developing countries and so on, space economies. So which could be the most important issues for the future, according to your opinion?
I think the most important issue facing us in the coming years and beyond is war and peace. There are many examples right now. Some are closer to you, such as the war in Ukraine and the threat that poses. There are various wars in the Mideast, Israel wars. There's a very worrisome potential for conflict between the United States and China over Taiwan. And each of these two countries thinks it's right, is quite sure it's right. So it's very, their countries are, both China and the United States are armed to the teeth and completely certain that their views are correct. So I think this has been an issue in the past. We've gone through, if you look at history, the last 80 years have been one of the most peaceful periods in human history, in recorded human history. There have been basically no major conflicts. There have been a few, there have been big conflicts, but no global conflicts. The number of battle deaths has declined sharply since 1945. We think political scientists who've looked at this think this is due to the, in good part, to the rise of democracy and to the rise of alliances, and that looks right to me. So I think this is something that's on the top of the agenda, because if Russia is fighting with the West or China is fighting with the U.S., none of our other global issues are going to be solved. Now, I'd like to just say one other thing. There's an important interaction between the environment and war, because war is the enemy of the environment. In periods of war, there's massive destruction of natural and built structures, dams, human cities, and so on. There's dangers, massive dangers to nuclear power plants, and which would threaten Chernobyl-type disasters. The environment and war seem like different areas, different sectors, but they're both part of a general framework that requires international cooperation and support, requires people to behave in mature ways, to take the long view, requires cooperation among democracies who share a vision of a peaceful Earth.
Thank you. So I think also it's very important also, also the relationship between water and the future world. I'm not worried about this point because water will be very important for the future. It's important today, but it's important also for also for the future in general. I think it's also looking at the climate change reduction of water, the reduction of glaciers that is now as mentioned. So it's, you are looking at what we should do in the future. One of the big problems will be the quantity of water and also probably a link between war and water. So, and according to what you have said so far. So another point, looking also about the future, no? If you think of the future, one of the possible can say future we can see is a future in which everything is done by robots or machines. So in different kinds, no, in the supply chain, this was produced everything by machines, and so which could be the role also driven by artificial intelligence. In these days, we are speaking about a lot about Chat GPT or other different AI that can help for the future, but in other case can also substitute workers. And so the question is about the future, is what about humans? Which could be your idea about our role in the future?
Yeah, this of course is a major question. It's one that's new, not brand new in the sense we've talked about it in the past, but in the sense of the new machines, if you like, have been extremely surprising. These are the what are called large language models, and there are actually many of them now being developed, small and large. And like others, I've been astounded by their performance and capabilities. Well, one of the interesting features of these models, which has been surprising even to their developers, is what are known as emergent properties. This means basically the total is more than the sum of the parts. And so these large language models do things that are very surprising. The fact that they, for example, they can code, maybe not very well now, but it's getting better. They can write poetry. They can write Shakespearean sonnets. At some point, they would be able to engage in psychotherapy. Now, there have been some surveys of economists about the economic importance of these AI. The Booth School at Chicago has a panel. I'm a member of it. I'm sometimes in the majority and sometimes in the minority. This one I'm in the minority. But they asked the panel how important they thought these AI, these large language models, would be for the economy. And the panel's view was they would be more important than the internet. Now, that's a pretty big impact if you think of all that's happened as a result of the internet over the last 30 years. So the economists think it's a very, very large impact. Now, I'm not so sure myself. If we think from an economic point of view, you think of the standard economics that output is produced by, we used to say capital labor and land, or capital labor, land, and information, or capital labor, land, and technology. But this is one, the AI is one of the factors of production. It basically is taking human knowledge and in a way digesting it and producing answers, whether it's code, whether it's a sonnet, or whether it's a history of Northern Italy, it can do all these things. But it still can't do many things. It can't harvest your tomatoes. it can't cut your hair, it can't engage in manufacturing. So information by itself can make a big difference, as the internet has, as Google search engines have, but it's a long way from being able to engage in the entire range of productive activities. Now, will it be able to do that? Will it be able to combine with other machines? You could think of the ideal robot who just can do everything that humans can do. We don't know. Here, the crystal ball is very, very cloudy, and it will take many, many years to know that. But I just want to say it's not obvious that because you have something like AI that can answer your questions and can answer them accurately and doesn't just make things up the way AI does today, but has a certain wisdom that AI doesn't appear to have. It isn't clear that that's going to be enough to get to the stage where they can replace human activity and human inputs and human wisdom. And there are many areas where they never will. They never will for political office. They never will for judges. And they never will for major decisions. Or if they do, it would be a different, it would probably be very unwise for them to do. So again, this is a major change. It's a what we call a big tail event, like a pandemic or a depression, but it's a tail event, maybe a good tail event. But its long-term implications are very, very hard to understand.
Okay, thank you very much. Yes. About the big tail events. Now moving to our current events. So looking at, for example, COVID crisis, Russia-Ukraine war, what we have learned about this in our recent history. And so I think that this probably could be also combined what is written in the top of your book, that is the economics of collision and contagions in a crowded world. Is also a manner to explain how the world is so complex. So there are other things, more things that are combined. One of the things that we have learned from our last current events is COVID crisis, Russia-Ukraine war, is the importance, how is important the role of rare materials in the supply chain. We have also spoken about reshoring and other things related to this problem. To which extent do you believe, which is your thought about the role of rare materials in the energy transition, what we have learned about this? And also, again, the geopolitical risk inside this, and which is the role of political geopolitical risk that could be played in the energy transition?
Yeah. Well, let me say there are really two issues here.
Yeah.
One is the retreat from globalization, and the other one is the rare earth minerals. So one of the things we've learned, and we learned it so slowly, but we learned it very, very rapidly in 2020 with the COVID crisis and the shutdown of international trade, is that we had probably tilted the balance too far toward economic integration. Not from a political, I'm not saying that from a political point of view, but I'm saying that from an economic point of view. When you think of integrating, putting your say you Apple, an Apple iPhone, which has parts coming from, I don't know, 60 different countries. Here, goes to here, here, painted here, assembled here, shipped here, sold here. So something like the iPhone, we know that it's a very global product. But when you think of that, if all goes well, it is a very inexpensive product to produce. So a $500 iPhone might cost $150 to produce, and the rest is just markup along the line. But then when things go wrong, because the parts in this particular product, you need a camera, you need a screen, you need the case, you need all the components. If for some reason the supply chain breaks down because you've spread it out all around the world, then you take a big hit. So we probably, certainly in retrospect, probably in prospect, we over-optimized the production, assuming very low supply chain risks. So it was a very good solution as long as the supply chain was stable, but we're probably now going to tilt back a little in the other direction. And that other direction is one which will be, in normal times, more expensive to produce, but in times of turmoil will be less expensive. So it's this trade-off between what happens in tail periods and what happens in normal periods. I think in designing our production processes around the world, particularly for some things like, just take the iPhone as an example, we had probably optimized too much for normal times and it ignored tail risk. And there are lots and lots of tail risks. It's not just pandemics, it's also wars, it's political conflicts and so on and so forth. So I'd say we're seeing some rebalancing of the modes of production in light of a reevaluation of risks, and particularly tail risks, and particularly in industries where you have these inelastic production, if I could use that term, where you have to have a phone in an iPhone, you have to have a camera in an iPhone, so you can't design a system where you might not be able to get the camera. Okay. You can talk, you don't have to have the paint done in some place, the paint could be somewhere else, but you have to have a camera. So that's a kind of general idea. Now, if we talk, let's talk a minute about rare earth minerals. First place, the first thing to remember is they're not rare. Right? Yeah. There are different ones, but it's just a name. And I don't actually know who invented the name. Whoever invented it was quite ingenious as a marketing device, but they're not rare. And if we can take the case of lithium, lithium actually has vast resources around the world. The resources of lithium around the world are more than 1,000 times annual production. So the idea that we're going to run out of lithium is just, it's like we're going to run out of oil, or we're going to run out of copper, or we're going to run out of uranium. It's not realistic. But what is realistic is that there are short-run supply constraints, and that the difficulties of mining, processing, refining, and so on are complicated. And they will take time to develop at the level we need, or we think we'll need, for say electric vehicles and other battery operated equipment. Now, maybe it will be up things other than lithium, in which case that will go away. But it seems to me that it's very unlikely that there will be a lithium shortage in 50 years. It seems to be highly unlikely. Just as in 1973, when the oil prices went up, it would be very unlikely there's an oil shortage in 50 years. So I think markets will work. This is a place where markets work. There are lots of supply countries. There are lots of countries would love to have lithium producing on their shores and make money on it. So I think this is a short run problem. And I think that the main thing we should do is not think of them as rare earth minerals.
Okay, thank you. Again, speaking about, again, war in Ukraine, another thing that we have learned is about the role of, so this word that is energy security. So I know this is a typical thing that is explained in energy economics, but for many times, we have not thought about the problem related to energy security, especially in Europe. No, was one of the big problems for us, especially in Italy. So we need, in Germany, in Europe, related to the link between Russia for gas. And so one of the effects was linked to this was also an inflation. It's not only the only cause, but it's one of the causes. The energy security, the world security. The question is how this kind of inflation driven by energy prices can be an obstacle for or a possible effect could be the effect on this on climate change and then zero emission targets. So which could be the link? Maybe could reduce now the acceleration versus towards our targets.
Yeah, that's a very interesting and difficult question. It's another one where the crystal ball is cloudy. Let me just say something about the the energy security issue. I mean, we all, as all countries, think about this. United States thinks about it, Japan thinks about it, China, EU, and then countries within the EU. And I think the problem was another, it's another example where the EU really didn't face the tail risk here of a really sharp break with Russia and Russian supply. Now, what's interesting, of course, is the break with Russia was decided by the EU, not by Russia. So it was, you know, if you like, self-imposed, but that's not important. But this was a tail risk. How big a tail risk, we really can't say, but it was a tail risk. I think in hindsight, for reasons that I hope that you and your analysts will help us understand, it turns out to have been less harmful than we had first anticipated, that the decline in European output, the rise in unemployment were less sharp than had been anticipated. Now, maybe part of that was a mild winter, but I suspect it was more than that as well. But I think the first thing is to do a kind of postmortem on this event and use this as an occasion to think again about how to think about tail events and how to anticipate them, like the pandemic, like the war in Ukraine, like the breakdown in globalization and supply chains. Now, turning to the second part of your question, which is about the impact on energy use and on the transition. There are really two parts of that. One is, if you think what is happening is Europe is forced to go off natural gas, so which is a fossil fuel, but a low carbon fossil fuel. So to the extent it goes to other fossil fuels, that will increase emissions, which has happened.
Yeah.
To the extent it goes to renewables, it decreases emissions. But it seems to me what's likely over the longer run is that as energy prices go up, particularly in a high carbon price environment like the EU, that this will mainly spur renewables rather than the alternative, which would be coal. So it would seem to me, at least for Europe, this would be, in the short run, probably higher emissions, but in the longer run, it would actually enhance the transition to low carbon energy, because actually renewables are more domestic, and you want to move away from potentially vulnerable energy supplies. You move away from fossil fuels, which Europe has very little of, to domestically produced fuels. This does leave a big problem we might return to later of what you use for your base load, because you do need some base load power production, particularly in an increasing electrical world. And that's a bigger problem. But I don't see it as a positive, but I see it in terms of the energy transition, at least not a negative.
Yeah, I understand. Yes. So short run and long run effect. So in long run, we could have some good effect in order to not move.
Exactly.
Yeah, perfect. So speaking about coordination, now is a question that is combined looking at which could be the coordination or coordination failure, depends which is your opinion about this. One of these is, are there two strategies to achieve more optimistic results from the new COP, Conference of Parties? Because in some cases, at the end, in some cases, we obtain some results. In some cases, are positive, other negatives. So is the results in general is not so. So in only one direction. Related to this, is an instrument, but is related also to coordination. Probably you partially have also answered speaking about the Climate Club and the EU as a possible Climate Club. But the question is related to carbon border adjustment mechanism. What is your opinion about this?
So really, two parts of your question. One is the the party mechanism, and the other is the carbon border adjustment.
Yes.
Well, I spoke a little earlier about the carbon club and the idea that we need a transition to a low carbon economy. And we talked about the three mechanisms, the pricing, the climate club, and the energy R&D. But I want to say first something about the Conference of the Parties. The Conference of the Parties, you can think of this as a mechanism, as a international organization, like the IMF, or like the World Bank, or like the Bureau of International Settlements, or like the United Nations. But in my view, it is deeply flawed as a mechanism because of its structure. And there are two particular parts that make it, that are flawed. The first one, it relies on unanimity for its decisions. And now we know from history, from theory, from political science, from game theory, that unanimity is a recipe for doing nothing. It's a recipe for the status quo, because if you have to get everybody to agree on a change, then there will be no change. So one of the flaws is it relies on unanimity rather than majority rule or weighted majority rule or supermajority. I mean, Europe as well, Europe knows well about issues of unanimity and the problems they raise. Then the second, which is similar but a little different, is it also is it's unweighted voting. So the little tiny countries have the same weight as the big countries. China and Botswana, the United States and Ecuador all have the same weights in the Conference of the Parties. So basically it's a decision structure that is not matched to solve the problem. And so this is already a particularly complicated problem, but what you need to do is find mechanisms that will be effective in approaching it. No game theorist, no political scientist, no economist, no practicing politician would recommend this approach. What we know is that it's a tool for the status quo. If you want to get nothing done, let your decision rule be unanimity. Now, the second question you asked was about the carbon border adjustment mechanism. Well, I'm of two minds here. Let's just call it the border tax. I don't think the border tax by itself is an appropriate mechanism. I think what you need to do is you need to embed that in a larger agreement for carbon, climate policy and carbon pricing. So in the climate club, the idea was you have a group of countries, they agree on a minimum price, say $50 per ton of CO2 emissions. And then countries that are not in it have a border tax adjustment or a uniform tariff on their imports into the club region. But just to have this as a device to beat up on your neighbor who doesn't meet your standards, it sounds like it doesn't really serve the function of getting a functional climate club. So I think it's a kind of cart before a horse idea. You really need to get the whole mechanism together before you do this. And then the other important point is, this has got to be part of an international agreement. This can't be just one region or one country doing it. It has to be part of a broader agreement of, just to pick countries, that the EU, the US, Japan, China, ideally those four regions, groups of countries. And then you would have a functional and effective climate club. And that would be the place in which you would put some kind of, it's not border tax adjustment. What it is, it's an incentive mechanism to get other countries to join.
Okay, thank you very much. Italy recently experienced a flood disaster. So we have in the last 2 months a problem in Romania especially. Looking at the percentage of houses that had insurance coverage, we look at a very low level of percentage, was very, very low. The problem is that we discovered that there is a low level of houses with insurance. In other cases, in some cases, the insurance companies have no interest in ensuring an event of such a high magnitude, even if the probability is so lower, is low, but with a climate change, there is a higher probability that is increasing year by year. So one of the points is if insurance could be a manner in order to work in for climate change, against climate change, obviously. And another point is, could public or public-private insurance be a possible strategy to better manage climate change? For maybe could it also favor mitigation, maybe by creating a public fund for abatement investment, or could it favor behavior driven by moral hazard?
Okay, so this is a very interesting, very practical question. This comes back to our discussion of adaptation. Because what you need to do is you need to design structures, in this case insurance, that promotes adaptation, but does it in an effective way and doesn't subsidize risky activities. So if I can just go back to the basic theory of insurance.
Yeah.
The basic theory of private insurance is that private insurance works well when there are independent risks, statistically independent risks. So for example, automobile accidents, fires in houses, kitchen fires in houses, are things, property damage, wind damage, well, maybe not so much wind damage, but these are events where you'll have their events that occur, they're statistically independent, insurance companies can pool these risks and sell insurance at a premium to people. And these markets they're not perfect, but they work effectively. I mean, the fire insurance, most of our houses in the United States have fire insurance. It's relatively inexpensive. These are tail events that people insure against. Where private insurance doesn't work is where you have either very, very large events or events where they're very highly correlated, so they're not independent. And this would be things like hurricanes, floods, obviously, war events. So these are ones where you have maybe a whole region might be inundated or hit by a hurricane or by a flood. And these are places where private insurance companies, they're very loath to participate, both because of the fact they're not independent events and also because they're very large. Now, to the extent they're very large, reinsurance can help with that. But to the extent that these are very highly correlated, it's much more difficult. So I would say in these events where they're large and or highly correlated, these are places where a public-private partnership works well. I would just add, our experience in the United States has been that pure public insurance does not work very well because it tends to be subject to the political process, gets heavily subsidized. We tend to subsidize people in flood zones. People move into floods, subsidize insurance, and therefore people move too much into flood zones, and therefore we have too many incidents there. So it's a very good question, but I think either private or private-public partnerships, depending on the structure of the risk, is a way to go.
Okay, thank you very much. Yes, understand. Okay. So the last question is about nuclear power. So what do you think about fission and fusion nuclear power for energy transition and reduction of CO2 emissions? With concluding, looking at this kind of new source of energy.
Well, fission power is an existing technology.
Yes.
It has all the shortcomings we know. It's high cost. It's got potential for catastrophic releases, as we've seen in Japan and other places. But it's also the only baseload non-carbon source of electricity. So it's a very important source. It's not pretty, if I could say, but it's practical and it exists. And we've done it now for more than 50 years. So fission is here. Fission is part of the world, and fission, We know its strengths and weaknesses. Now, fusion is a different story. I've followed fusion for 5 decades. I remember cold fusion. I remember hot fusion. I remember all the different things. And I don't think it has made much progress. I mean, it has gotten from to the point of technological, where of what I'll call input-output feasibility. There's more output than input, but this is at extreme cost. That was just passed, I think, last year. So it seems like a low probability source. It's worth continuing research and development along with other things, but I personally don't think that's going to be. I think that's low probability. I think improved fission is a better bet. Now, since we asked about future technology, I'll just tell you my own personal favorite, which would be a game changer, which is superconducting transmission. Now, we know that superconducting transmission of electricity is possible, basically zero losses, but we have not been able to find a technology that does it at a cost and scale. But we know it's feasible. It's so in a way, it's like fusion, it's feasible. But it's been making steady steps forward. But if you had large scale superconducting electricity, it would be a complete game changer for the global energy system, because you could generate electricity in places where it's essentially free, such as Greenland with its huge waterfalls, or the desert with the sun, and you could transmit it costlessly to the areas of demand. Now, if I had to make a single bet, I would put it there, but luckily we don't have to make single bets. We can bet on many things. And that's part of the attraction of the enhanced support for energy, low carbon R&D, is to find many of these areas. Maybe some people like fusion, maybe some people like superconductivity, maybe some people like geothermal, maybe some people like other remote sources and other technologies, but we don't have to pick one, because we have the funds, particularly at the smaller scale, to do many of them. Direct air capture, we don't need to neglect that, or carbon capture and sequestration. All of these are possibilities for using our vast energy resources in effective, efficient, and low carbon ways. So I think with that, I'd say, as they say in France, faites vos jeux, with respect to the different R&D sources.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. So we have to combine a lot of different instruments in order to fight. No, there is not only one. No, you need a lot of different in order to fight this kind of war again. Climate change. So because we have to increase our effort in different direction.
Okay, yeah, so I would say it's like if you pick your stock portfolio, don't put it all in one company. You get a portfolio. Of your research and development activities.
Yes. Not have to edge different shares. Okay. Thank you very much. I think I've learned a lot, I have to say, but because I have taken also some things and some points here about what you have said. So also some news for me, superconducting transition, also the link about energy green R&D, that is one of the other important elements, I think, for policies. And so I thank you very much, Bill, for your time from FEEM, because we are here also for your research is very, very important for us, was and it is, and also for the future. And so we can close here, and thank you for all of us. Thank you.
Well, it's a great pleasure to be with you, to see you, and hello to all the people who watch this. I really admire FEEM. I've been there, and I really admire your work. So keep it up.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
Goodbye.
Bye-bye.